Through here. We're almost at the... Miranda.
Oh.
But you were...
Oh my god. Wilson! Dad.
What the hell are you doing?
She killed Wilson.
My job. Wilson betrayed us all.
Ooh, I'm arming. I'm aiming my gun right at her. So this is your idea of due process?
Even if you're sure, did he deserve that welcome? He sabotaged the security systems, killed my staff, and he would have killed us.
You sure about that, Miranda? We've known Wilson for years. What if you're wrong?
I'm never wrong. I thought you'd have learned that by now, Jacob.
Well, now you can't question him.
You should have taken him alive, see what he knew.
Too risky. I've put too much time and effort bringing you back to life to let you get killed now.
You really think Wilson's capable of that?
Not anymore.
Okay, what happens now?
If you say so. What's our next step?
We get on the shuttle and go. My boss wants to speak to you.
You mean the elusive man? I know you work for Cerberus.
Ah, Jacob. I should have known your conscience would get the better of you.
Don't shoot him.
Lying to the commander isn't the way to get her to join our cause.
Well, since we're getting everything out in the open, is there anything else you want to ask before we go, Commander?
Abso-fraggin-lutely. Tell me all about this Lazarus project.
You're the Lazarus project's director, aren't you?
That's right. I put 2 years of my life into this project. Into you.
Why? Because I'm very important in leading humanity, I know.
What does Cerberus want from me?
Maybe you should ask the elusive man when you meet him. He poured virtually unlimited resources into Lazarus. Obviously, he has some kind of plan for you.
What's our destination?
Where are we going?
Another Cerberus facility. The elusive man is waiting for you there.
And if I don't agree to come along?
Not sure I trust you.
This is the only shuttle off the station. You want to stay and rot with the mechs? Be my guest.
Yeah, like you'd really let me do that after 2 years. Location. Well, where was your location? I guess her location.
Convenient that you show up as we're leaving. Where were you during the attack?
Besides trying to save your life? Wilson figured out I was helping you and he sent an army of mechs to take me out. I got here as soon as I could. Probably a little too soon if you ask Wilson.
Well, like you said, we can't ask him anything anymore, can we? Were there any other survivors?
What about the rest of the people on the station?
This is the evac area. If they're not here now, they're not coming.
Well, some of them might have survived.
We can't leave without knowing for sure. We need to go back and look.
Don't you get it? The only one worth saving is you. Everyone else is expendable.
She's right. We all knew the risks when we signed up. Without you, there's no point to any of this.
Yeah, let's go.
I've had enough of this station to last a lifetime.
Or two, in your case. Come on.
Oh, wow. Ooh. How surprised such a small craft was capable of that.
Before you meet with the elusive man, we need to ask a few questions to evaluate your condition.
Come on, Miranda. More tests? Shepard took down those mechs without any trouble. That has to be good enough.
It's been 2 years since the attack. The elusive man needs to know that Shepard's personality and memories are intact. Ask the questions.
2 years, huh?
Did you say 2 years? I've been gone that long?
We've been saying it all along.
2 years and 12 days. And you were on an operating table for most of it.
The 12 days, though, you know.
The sooner we start, the sooner we can be done. Start with personal history.
Okay. Records show you were a spacer kid. Raised mostly on one ship or another. You enlisted and won a medal fighting Batarians during the Skillian Blitz. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I had no choice.
A lot of lives depended on me holding that position. I did what I had to.
However you want to put it, it was damn impressive. I had friends who were there. Satisfied, Miranda?
Almost. Let's try something more recent. Vermeier, where you destroyed Saren's cloning facility. You had to leave one of your squad behind to die in the blast.
Oh my.
Lieutenant Caden Alenko was killed in action. It was your call. Why did you leave him behind?
Well, I've explained to you guys why. It was a hard choice. Well, it was that or die.
Being in command means that sometimes you give orders knowing that your people are gonna die. That can't affect your decisions. Caden gave his life for the rest of the team. Without him, I couldn't have stopped Saren. He died a hero.
And we didn't give the order.
I understand, Commander. And I wasn't judging your decision. Everybody at Cerberus knows that cloning facility had to be destroyed.
Shepard, think back to the Citadel. After the Council died on the Destiny Ascension, and you killed Saren. What happened next?
Saren came back to life under the control of... Sovereign? We destroyed that thing so well I can barely remember it. Well, it's been 2 years. Anderson led the new Council.
With the Council dead, humanity stepped into power. We formed a new Council. I recommended Captain Anderson to lead it.
Yes, Captain Anderson is now Counselor Anderson.
Right.
Though from what I hear, he preferred life in the military.
Still, yeah. Good to know that the human council member isn't going to put politics ahead of defense.
Your memory seems solid. There are other tests we really should run.
Come on, Miranda. Enough with the quizzes. The memories are there, and I can vouch for Shepard's combat skills personally.
I suppose you're right. We'll have to hope the elusive man accepts our little field test as evidence enough.
Right, so you're now watching part two of a, I guess, a two-parter. We're basically 40 minutes in.
The elusive man is waiting for you in the other room.
Thank you. There's so much talking and stuff, I didn't have a chance to save the game. It's like a Paragon Actions.
I wouldn't keep the elusive man waiting.
Oh boy. I'm not intimidated by this Joker. Sorry, I didn't mean to bring up Joker.
The elusive man is waiting for you in the other room.
The other room. Ooh. Customize gear. Oh my, turn burst. Now some of this stuff is DLC, I think the Cerberus Assault Armor, I'm not sure. Oh my god. Collector Chitin Armor? Blood Dragon Armor, I know it's from the DLC. Cerberus Assault Armor is designed for shock troops who are expected to turn the tide of battle against creatures or forces that would decimate normal soldiers. The troops demanded three things in its design: shield and armor thick enough to last against a superior foe, and a rechargeable pack to extend a heavy weapon power cell. The only drawback of the armor is its weight, which the troops carry as a point of pride. They have a saying, out of shape going in shape coming out. We can look at it like that. Heavy weapon ammo capacity by 10%. Shields and health by 10%. Okay. Collector Chitin Armor. Cerberus adapted this suit for you out of salvaged collector technology. Well, this is kind of a spoiler because I didn't know anything about these collectors, I guess. The collector's chitinous armor is flexible and even tougher than ballistic fibers. Its organic construction allows it to be self-healing, and the muscle-like tissue that assists movement ensures it is comfortable to wear despite its weight. Yet we look kind of like a monster. Regen bonus 10, storm speed 10, health plus 20. That's pretty good. Regen bonus instead of ammo capacity. And shields. Blood Dragon Armor. It's from the DLC. Originally created for Earth's Urban Combat Championship League. This set of armor has undergone as much or more field testing than those of modern militaries. It uses a unique proprietary power cell that costs as much as a UECC rookie's contract. The armor's microframe computer adapts to any top-tier Omni-tool, kinetic barrier, or biotic amp, giving breathtaking and error-free performance. The chest and shoulder piece bears the logo of the Edmonton Blood Dragons, and the inside of the armor bears the signatures of the entire team. I got this armor signed. When and how the elusive man gets his hands on the armor is unknown, but several of the signatures bear messages such as Bleep, the Gath, and Shepherd, get well soon. Increases power damage by 10% and shield by 15%, I'm sorry, and shield by 10. And terminus armor. Environmentally sealed with an independent air supply for use in space and extreme planetary conditions. It's onboard, I guess, microframe computer runs a suite of battle management software. To prevent detection by passive thermal sensors, body heat is channeled to the base of the feet and dispersed into the ground. I like increasing the ammo, because I have a feeling I'm going to run out of ammo a lot. You know, unless I play on casual, which I'm going to try not to do. Storm speed by 10, shields 15. I'm going to take this. Terminus armor. And then casual appearance. Looked like Dr. Chak was there. I think we're fine with the way it is. So now I'm all armored up. Do I have to be armored up here? I guess I just am. This room, I guess? Hello? Or just beam me up here?
Commander Shepard.
Oh, I'm a hologram up here.
Illusive man. I thought we'd be meeting face to face.
Unnecessary precaution. Not unusual for people who know what you and I know.
That's a very, very familiar voice. I'm gonna have to look that up. What do we know?
What exactly is it that you and I know?
That our place in the universe is more fragile than we'd like to think. That one woman, one very specific woman, might be all that stands between humanity and the greatest threat of our brief existence.
The Reapers.
Good to see your memory still intact. How are you feeling?
Skip the pleasantries.
Cut to the chase. What are the Reapers doing that made you decide to bring me back?
We're at war. No one wants to admit it, but humanity is under attack. While you've been sleeping, entire colonies have been disappearing. Human colonies. We believe it's someone working for the Reapers. Just as Saren and the Geth aided Sovereign. You've seen it yourself. You bested all of them. That's just one reason we chose you.
This is Cerberus, then.
Fighting a war doesn't seem like Cerberus. Why are you involved?
We're committed to the advancement and preservation of humanity. If the Reapers are targeting us, trying to wipe us out, Cerberus will stop them. If we wait for politicians or the Alliance to act, no more human colonies will be left.
Why me?
You could have trained an entire army for what you spent to bring me back.
You're unique. Not just in ability or what you've experienced, but in what you represent. You stood for humanity at a key moment. You're more than a soldier. You're a symbol. And I don't know if the Reapers understand fear, but you killed one. They have to respect that.
Right, so I'm a symbol against the Reapers, and I will help morale for humanity, I suppose. Abductions of these colonies, I guess?
Sovereign was trying to harvest all life in the galaxy. Why would the Reapers target a few human colonies?
Hundreds of thousands of colonists have vanished. I'd say that fits the definition of harvesting. Nobody's paying attention because it's random, and the attacks occur in remote locations. I don't know why they've suddenly targeted humanity. Maybe you got their attention when you killed one of them.
Huh. Maybe. Can we get aid from the Alliance?
If this is a threat against humanity, You need to mobilize the Alliance.
The Alliance is overwhelmed by the responsibility you gave them. They're too busy building relations to put resources into verifying the Reaper threat. Blaming the abductions on mercs and pirates is easier and more convenient.
Maybe I believe you.
If what you say is true, if the Reapers are behind this, I'd consider helping you.
I'd be disappointed if you accepted any of this without seeing for yourself. I have a shuttle ready to take you to Freedom's Progress, the latest colony to be abducted. Miranda and Jacob will brief you.
And I'm supposed to trust them?
Miranda killed Wilson in cold blood. Jacob's just a gun for hire. You expect me to trust them?
Wilson was one of my best agents, but he was a traitor. Miranda did exactly what I expected of her, and she saved your life in more ways than one. Jacob's a soldier, one of the best. He's never fully trusted me, but he's always been honest about it. You'll be just fine with them. For now.
So, right. Wilson was obviously a traitor, but who is he working for? Do I have a choice?
Is this a volunteer job, or am I being volunteered?
You always have a choice, Shepard. If you don't find the evidence we're both looking for, we can part ways. But first, go to Freedom's Progress. Find any clues you can. Who's abducting the colonies? Do they have any connection to the Reapers? I brought you back. It's up to you to do the rest.
Level 4. My, all this stuff popping up. A ship is waiting for you in the hangar bay. All this Codex crap popping up. What did I do to get Paragon and Renegade just now? My choices with talking to him, I guess? Still no map available. So, alright. I want some shockwave here. And pull. Oh. I can't take that. I still have a point. There you go. So yeah, still leaning towards Paragon. Journal. Look for clues that might explain what happened to the missing colonists. The Illusive Man would like a team to investigate disappearances. You escaped the Cerberus medical facility. Mark all viewed. It didn't do anything anyway. Okay, I'm just gonna read the Codex for a little bit, and this will be the end of this episode. So if you guys want to tune in, otherwise I'm gonna listen to and possibly read the Codex. Some of it's just going off over stuff we already know, but there might be new things that happened in within 2 years anyway.
The Asari were the first species to discover the Citadel. When the Salarians arrived, it was the Asari who proposed the establishment of the Citadel Council to maintain peace throughout the galaxy. Since then, the Asari have served as the mediators and centrists of the Council. An all-female race, the Asari reproduce through a form of parthenogenesis. They can attune their nervous system to that of another individual of any gender and of any species to reproduce. This capability has led to the unseemly and inaccurate rumors about Asari promiscuity. Asari can live for over 1,000 years, passing through 3 stages of life. In the maiden stage, they wander restlessly, seeking new knowledge and experience. When the matron stage begins, they meld with interesting partners to produce their offspring. This ends when they reach the matriarch stage, where they assume the roles of leaders and counselors.
Again, the whole Asari thing, they've applied basic Wiccan concepts. The 3 stages are the same. I believe it's more like maiden. Could be matron or a mother. And the last stage is the crone. Anyway, Solarians.
The second species to join the Citadel, the Solarians are warm-blooded amphibians with a hyperactive metabolism. Solarians think fast, talk fast, and move fast. To Solarians, other species seem sluggish and dull-witted. Unfortunately, their metabolic speed leaves them with a relatively short lifespan. Solarians over the age of 40 are a rarity. The Solarians were responsible for advancing the development of the primitive Krogan species to use as soldiers during the Rachni Wars. They were also behind the creation of the genophage bioweapon the Turians used to quell the Krogan rebellion several centuries later. Solarians are known for their observational capability and non-linear thinking. This manifests as an aptitude for research and espionage. They are constantly experimenting and inventing, and it is generally accepted that they always know more than they are letting on.
Yeah, I see that fits. Still, though, I can't believe a lifespan of just 40.
Roughly 1,200 years ago, the Turians were invited to join the Citadel Council to fulfill the role of galactic peacekeepers. The Turians have the largest fleet in Citadel space, and they make up the single largest portion of the Council's military forces. As their territory and influence has spread, the Turians have come to rely on the Solarians for military intelligence and the Asari for diplomacy. Despite a somewhat colonial attitude towards the rest of the galaxy, the ruling hierarchy understands they would lose more than they would gain if the other two races were ever removed. Turians come from an autocratic society that values discipline and possesses a strong sense of personal and collective honor. There is lingering animosity between Turians and humans over the First Contact War of 2157, which is known as the Relay 314 incident to the Turians. Officially, however, the two species are allies, and they enjoy civil, if cool, diplomatic relations.
Extinct races? See, oh.
The Asari were the...
Asari disappeared.
50,000 years ago, the Protheans were the only spacefaring species in the galaxy.
Right.
They vanished in a swift galactic extinction.
Statues.
Only the legacy of their empire remains. They are believed to have built the mass relays and the Citadel, which have allowed numerous species to explore and expand throughout the galaxy. Prothean ruins are found on worlds across the galaxy. While surprisingly intact for their age, functioning examples of Prothean paleotechnology are rare. Time and generations of looters have picked their dead cities and derelict stations clean. Some believe the Protheans meddled in the evolution of younger races. The Hanar homeworld of Kadje, for example, shows clear evidence of former Prothean occupation.
The Enkindlers.
The presence of a former Prothean observation post on Mars has caused a rebirth of interventionary evolutionists among humans. These individuals believe the god myths of ancient civilizations are misremembered encounters with aliens.
Yeah, it's possible. I mean, if you land on a planet and you have a vastly, basically, a vast technology, you know, wide gap in technology, they're going to either think it's magic or they're going to think you're gods or both. But yeah, the whole thing with the Hanar is they call them the Enkindlers. They think they created their race, or actually evolved, caused their race to evolve. But yeah, we saw these statues on Ilos at the end of Mass Effect. Well, the first Mass Effect. makes sense that it's them. Non-council races.
In the early 2160s, the Alliance began aggressive colonization of worlds in the Skillian Verge, much to the dismay of the Batarians, who had been developing the region for several decades. In 2171, the Batarians petitioned the Council to declare the Verge a zone of Batarian interest. The Council refused, however, declaring unsettled worlds in the region open to human colonization. In protest, the Batarians closed their Citadel embassy and severed official diplomatic relations with the Council, effectively becoming a rogue state. They instigated a proxy war in the Verge by funneling money and weapons to criminal organizations, urging them to strike at human colonies. Hostilities peaked with the Skillian Blitz of 2176, an attack on the human capital of Elysium by Batarian-funded pirates and slavers. In 2178, the Alliance retaliated with a crushing assault on the moon of Torfin, long used as a staging base by Batarian-backed criminals. In the aftermath, the Batarians retreated into their own systems and are now rarely seen in Citadel space.
Right, so just a reminder, the Skillian Blitz is something that, Commander Shepard was present at least my Commander Shepard, and, I'm not sure if it was single-handedly or she assisted in helping the, colony. And, the only place we've actually seen these things is in the, Bring Down the Sky DLC. In Mass Effect 1 DLC. The Elcor.
The Elcor are a Citadel species native to the high-gravity world Dakuna.
I love these guys.
They are massive creatures, standing on four muscular legs for increased stability. Elcor move slowly, an evolved response to an environment where a fall can be lethal. This has colored their psychology, making them deliberate and conservative. Elcor's speech is ponderous and monotone. Among themselves, scent, slight movements, and sub-vocalized infrasound convey shades of meaning that make a human smile seem as subtle as a fireworks display.
Huh.
Since their subtlety can lead to misunderstandings with other species, the Elcor often go out of their way to clarify when they are being sarcastic, amused, or angry. Dakuna's high gravity impedes mountain formation. Most of the world consists of flat, open plains, which prehistoric Elcor wandered across in small family bands. Modern Elcor still prefer open sky, and can become restless and uncomfortable on long starship journeys.
I find these guys fascinating. That's interesting, though, that a world with high gravity would, prevent mountains from forming. I'd never consider that.
The Geth are a humanoid race of networked AIs. They were created by the Quarians 300 years ago as tools of labor and war. When the Geth showed signs of self-evolution, the Quarians attempted to exterminate them. The Geth won the resulting war. This example has led to legal, systematic repression of artificial intelligences in galactic society. The Geth possess a unique distributed intelligence. An individual has rudimentary animal instincts, but as their numbers and proximity increase, the apparent intelligence of each individual improves. In groups, they can reason, analyze situations, and use tactics as well as any organic race. Geth space is located at the trailing end of the Perseus Arm, beyond the lawless Terminus systems. The Perseus Veil, an obscuring dark nebula of opaque gas and dust, lies between their space and the Terminus systems.
Yeah, I can't stand these Geth. The Hanar, though, I find very fascinating as well.
The Hanar are a Citadel species known for excessive politeness. They speak with scrupulous precision and take offense at improper language. Hanar that expect to deal with other species take special courses to help them unlearn their tendency to take offense at improper speech.
Wow.
All Hanar have two names. The face name is known to the world. The soul name is kept for use among close friends and relations. Hanar never refer to themselves in the first person in conversation with someone they know on a face name basis. To do so is considered egotistical. So instead, they refer to themselves as this one, or the impersonal it. Their homeworld, Kage, has 90% ocean cover and orbits an energetic white star, resulting in a permanent blanket of cloud. Due to the presence of Prothean ruins on the world, many Hanar worship them, and Hanar myths often speak of an elder race that civilized them by teaching them language.
Right. They think they taught them language. I mean, could be. Krogans?
The Krogan evolved in a hostile and vicious environment. Until the invention of gunpowder weapons, eaten by predators was still the number one cause of Krogan fatalities. Afterwards, it was death by gunshot. When the Salarians discovered them, the Krogan were a brutal, primitive species, struggling to survive a self-inflicted nuclear winter. The Salarians culturally uplifted them, teaching them to use and build modern technology so they could serve as soldiers in the Rachni War. Liberated from the harsh conditions of their homeworld, the quick-breeding Krogan experienced an unprecedented population explosion. They began to colonize nearby worlds. Even though these worlds were already inhabited, the Krogan rebellions lasted nearly a century, only ending when the Turians unleashed the Genophage, a Salarian-developed bioweapon that crushed all Krogan resistance. The Genophage makes only 1 in 1,000 pregnancies viable, and today the Krogan are a slowly dying breed.
Understandably, the Krogan harbor a grudge against all other species, especially the Turians. I don't know why I didn't say that. Quarians.
Driven from their home system by the Geth nearly 3 centuries ago, most Quarians now live aboard the Migrant Fleet, a flotilla of 50,000 vessels ranging in size from passenger shuttles to mobile space stations. Home to 17 million Quarians, the flotilla understandably has scarce resources. Because of this, each Quarian must go on a rite of passage known as the Pilgrimage when they come of age. They leave the fleet and only return once they have found something of value they can bring back to their people. Other species tend to look down on the Quarians for creating the Geth and for the negative impact their fleet has when it enters a system. This has led to many myths and rumors about the Quarians, including the belief that underneath their clothes and breathing masks, they are actually cybernetic creatures, a combination of organic and synthetic parts.
Wow, really? That's new. Never heard that rumor. I could see how people would think that. I mean, we don't know what they look like underneath the mask. Now, the mask and the armor and stuff, but that would make sense that, you know, the reason they have this armor is so that they don't catch, like, you know, a cold or an illness or something like that, because they have very low immune systems. So they could catch an illness from us that, you know, we could be a carrier for, or, you know, even, you know, spare bacteria throughout our body. They could get ill. But, I mean, no pictures, no, you know, video or, like, transmissions from the flotilla that we could see what they look like either. That really wouldn't apply there, so why the secrecy, huh? Oh, Reapers.
A myth common to several cultures in the galaxy. Reapers were imagined to be space monsters who consumed entire stars. Archaeologists and mythologists attempting to uncover sources for such myths have yielded little, except interstellar religious themes of all-consuming devils common to primitive cultures.
Right, like the shadows on the Babylon 5 were... Babylon 5 show were kind of seen to be devils or demons, whereas the race, the Vorlons, I couldn't even remember, were, depending on what race looked at them, they looked like the angel of whatever race, or celestial being. I'm diverging here. Digressing. Volus.
The Volus are a member species of the Citadel with their own embassy, but they are also a client race of the Turians. Centuries ago, they were voluntarily absorbed into the hierarchy, effectively trading their mercantile prowess for Turian military protection. Erun, their homeworld, lies far beyond the normal life zone of its star. However, the world has a high-pressure greenhouse atmosphere that traps enough heat to support an ammonia-based biochemistry. As a result, The Volus must wear pressure suits and breathers when dealing with other species, as conventional nitrogen-oxygen air mixtures are poisonous to them, and in the low-pressure atmospheres tolerable to most species, their flesh will actually split open.
Ugh.
Volus culture is tribal, bartering lands and even people to gain status. This culture of exchange inclines them to economic pursuits. It was the Volus who authored the Unified Banking Act, and they continue to monitor and balance the Citadel economy.
Huh. The Unified Banking Act. Now I know we still got... Oh my god. We got all these, and we got secondary. But I'm gonna save that for another playthrough. I don't know. I could make an entire episode out of just the Codex. But yeah, I'll tag it onto the end of several videos until we catch up. I feel that's the best thing to do. Anyway, so thanks for watching, guys. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.